Hello everybody, welcome back to Ring of Fates. In this video, we're heading off to the Valley of Heroes, but before we do that, I'm going to show off the equipment on screen right now to the top right, and that way we can get the delicious flavor text of these four items before we head on off, because I'll be trying to cover off all those little bits of flavor text that we can get at, and maybe I'll show the rest that we didn't get to off screen. Well, that doesn't really work out, does it? After the video, if that so happens. At any rate, by heading off to the Valley of Heroes, we're in a very familiar area as a very unfamiliar race. So a lot of these early levels aren't designed for Selkies, especially the later levels, oddly enough, can easily be exploited. So they don't really take double jumping into account for, and you never really expected the players would play around, really. At any rate, nothing too much to worry about. We're going to be only taking on some moves right now. You can shoot a little bit faster by holding on one of the directional pad keys or move while firing. And this will speed things up quite tremendously, as you can tell. Standing still and moving a little bit. So it does help quite a bit. Something that you can always consider. And since we've got two lucky shots there, three, I'm going to be able to take out that move pretty quickly. Another thing to mention is that anything that used to require a specific race, let's say the Clevats with their like stone switches, Lotis with their pots, Yukes with their magical needles, they've all been replaced with things that Selkies can deal with since we're playing as the Selkie class. Although not everything is accounted for, oddly enough, so we'll get to those when we do. Otherwise, nothing too much to worry about. We're just going to slam straight into a boulder and die. And then there goes the multiplay playthrough. Another thing you can do is step on top of enemies and jump, smash them. This is really effective against crowds of enemies. Not so much single moves and whatnot. Something to consider if you're not doing enough firepower as much as you would like to. So let's just grab this money and head on through. This should lead us to a crossroads, which has two locked up paths and two open paths, one which we just came from and one which is the save point, which is something you can go after if you're into that. But otherwise, nothing too much to worry about. Let's just mosey on over here, activate the switch, and it will give us two doors open. Now we're not going to head off into the north door, but rather the east door, and it's not too much of a worry since they link back to each other afterwards, and I'm not going to bother with the safe room since we'll be able to get back to that later on, and I don't think we'll really need any healing or saving checkpointing at all. We'll get to that when we do. So by moving down here, we can deal with some skeletons, and this is the longer path, really. There's an even shorter path by going into the north door, and the easiest path by going into the west door with the safe house. But we can worry about that later since I'm trying to cover the entirety of the Valley of Heroes. I believe that's what it's called. I think I've forgotten already. I always get it mixed up. Anyways, over here we have a sign telling us about checking on the flavor text of items, which should hopefully be going on screen at a fair and even distribution. It's a little bit of worry for me since it means I'll have to get equipment off screen and not save that, and I'll have to get descriptions of items that I didn't get afterwards. It's a very strange thing since I'm trying to go for all the little items and stuff in each area, and I'm not sure if it's really well documented or not, but regardless, let's move on. And this is not one of the maps you'll be well acquainted with, albeit we'll be visiting this area repeatedly. So let's not worry too much about that and clear out the ground floor enemies. And what we're trying to do is work over to that door in the northeast right now, the locked door. And as you can see from beyond in the distance, it's covered in a few spikes there, but not too much to worry about. We've dealt with those before on our story mode playthrough, which we'll occasionally refer back to throughout this multiplayer playthrough, so don't you worry if you're missing some Yuri and Chelinka, or maybe you should just head on over to episode 1. I'm gonna try not to destroy that first spike though, that second spike rather, while we take care of the rest of these enemies here. I'll be trying to kill each of these guys once and only once, so we get the appropriate amount of EXP needed to move into each area without getting our faces smashed in, except when I'm just bad at the game. An easy thing to deal with for these bats is to just do two double jumps and go after its head. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work out, but usually you land most of your shots by doing this, and it won't take you too long. Now, let's get rid of this chest here. There we go. Clear magic sites aren't very helpful yet, since I don't believe we have a charge attack, but that will change very soon, so nothing to worry about. And it looks like we're going to be dealing with a bomb here as well. There we go, we got our charge attack. And by holding down our attack button, we'll be able to make a flashy thing and spend 30 SP, I believe, in order to do a little bit of a better hit. Very effective against flans, which are very strong against melee attacks, so something to consider. Alright, now before we head over into that northeast door, by going down here, we'll enter at the north of the crossways. And this is where you're able to skip a few levels and areas if you wanted to, but obviously not necessary. Let's take care of the skeletons so we can move on without too much of a problem. And it looks like we broke two of the spikes. In any regard, if you only had one spike broken and tried to walk through, it wouldn't let you. So definitely need to break two for that. Don't try to sneak in one. Don't try that or else you might, I don't know, snap your neck against the spikes. Something to consider. Let's heal up, break some barrels. But we have a little bit of an auto-targeting thing, which is why I can't pierce two at once, since it's going after that enemy that's nearby, the bomb. And let's do a little bit of stomping on you. We're doing quite a bit of damage right now to be able to ignite the bomb with a single hit, unless we hit him off-screen. Not too sure, though. Alright. So far, so good. There we go, another move down. Awesome. So, generally, this area is not too much to worry about, since you're getting a lot of vegetables and fruits in order to replenish your HP and SP, you don't really need to worry about magic sites either. Albeit, I'd like that if you're playing along, you should keep around two fire magic sites. And that's because you'll be able to unlock some permanent upgrades a little bit early on ahead now, sooner or later. And alongside that, you can get a lot of EXP from the skeletons you'll be encountering there. And I can talk about that more later on. Usually I'd like to do two attacks on the head and then drop down to do one regular bow attack against the skeleton in order to avoid getting smashed and smacked off. But otherwise, not too much to worry about. We'll worry about the bomb nearby first and maybe send a charge attack over in his direction. This fellow right here, there we go. Do a little bit more damage. And looks like things are going to be pretty done well. I cannot speak today. I'll try to take it at a slower pace without being too slow. That way we can get the information that must be conveyed through. Okay, so far so good. Worry about this bat. Very annoying. Not so good at the timing right now, but it's okay. Just woke up. No biggie. No pressure. Alright. One more bomb to deal with, and then, I don't know, maybe a little bitty more over near the end where we're trying to go for. Alright, let's head on through, and is anyone here? Nothing, cool, I'm just gonna take all this money here. Money should not be a problem whatsoever in multiplay, since you're not trying to fund for characters. So, if you're a little bit worried about money, don't worry. Well, that being said, if you're the kind of person who likes spending a lot and a lot of money, then don't worry, because by me showing you a lovely speedrun version of this, you'll be able to get through and get as much money as you want between each dungeon as necessary. So by going all the way through this ridiculous area, we will end up on the top area of that map that we just got to. So this is how we're going to be able to move on over to unlocking that red door over in the north. So nothing too much to worry about. A little bit weird to say, because that's technically like a west door, but the perspective of the map just changed, so I don't even know what to say. The northwest locked door. Too hard, too weird to deal with. Anyways, let's take care of the enemies up here, and we'll move on over this lovely key over to where we need to stick that key in. Because that's what you do with keys. You unlock things. Imagine that. Or do you unlock them? You might lock them. Who knows? Alright. Nothing too much to worry about. A cherry cluster. Always good in case you're into those charge attacks, which I am occasionally. don't know and don't feel like fighting these enemies, but it looks like I'm gonna have to because they're all, whatever. I'll just leave you guys. I'm pretty sure we killed them already. And with this, we end up at the save point, which we wanted to get at earlier. So there we go. I skipped it earlier because I didn't feel like we needed healing, but since we're here, we might as well go after a little bit of healing, the checkpoint, and the Mugo that is in this area. So you can find the Mugo right near the entrance steps, I believe. There we are. Talk to it. Get stamps if we had stamps, but we don't. So we're all A-OK. Something, something. So if you're a Soki, you can actually head to the save area and just double jump your way up here. As I said, these maps aren't really well prepared for Sokis and their double jump. If not, you can drop Magicites on the ground, which I'm not very good at. Let's just inch over here. There we go. You can just drop Magicites and climb up here as well. Two things to consider if you don't feel like going through the entire area, and this makes the Valley of Heroes very easy to get through. It's very good for story mode grinding as well if you're looking for a little bit of extra gil in order to do your permanent upgrades and whatnot. Something to definitely consider about. But by moving over here, we have a fire magicite barrier thing. I never know what to call them. They're all called switches by definition, I believe. So this doesn't really help me. At any rate, let's jump on top of their heads and get chain comboed. So let's leave. Oh my! That one got a really good aim on me. Whoa, okay. Alright, well, usually I'd recommend you just use a Blizzard Magicite on them and take them down one by one, since stomping on them like that, not very effective, especially since these are spellcasters that don't really worry about getting flinched or not. At any rate, by activating that fire barrier, we'll be able to head in here and we're gonna deal with like six skeletons. Oh my gosh, too many spookies around here. Now, we want to gather these guys up together, just because it's easier for us this way. And if I don't get knocked off right away and I don't end up in the center of this terrible pit of madness, you can actually jump on top of them and do a bunch of stomping damage on more than one at once. And this is really effective to get EXP, since you get as much damage as you can, and usually you're not knocked off as often as I am right now. So it's very good to get like a ton of EXP. If you're feeling like you're a little bit low, you can actually always leave and re-enter, albeit the items in here will never respawn. So there we go, we got a ton of gil, a bunch of bones and bricks and I don't know what else. Pretty good. Now, since we don't have enough fire magicites here, you don't actually need them all to activate the pedestal that moves you up here. Instead, if you're looking for a little bit of extra HP, just activate the candle here and three skeletons times two will just drop down and you'll be able to get a little bit more XP if you ever need it. Stuff to consider. As a Selkie, I get the benefit of showing you areas that I usually would not be able to if I didn't have the proper items, which is always great. Of course, Selkies, Yukes, and Lotis can always stack items on the ground and jump on those. But for me, it's going to be super duper easy because Selkia can double jump. Hooray for Selkies. Another thing to make it a lot easier if you're speedrunning but still going after that permanent upgrade. Ugh. Anyways, I don't recommend going after that bomb over there because it's a little bit stronger and you can probably tell because it's blue. So instead, we're going to hop into our tribal abilities here and fire some long range shots at it. And the great thing about the Selkie's tribal ability is that if you can shoot it, it'll just home directly on the target and you don't really have to be in its line of sight. And this is very And this is very effective because you'll be able to go for enemies at a height below it and just pretty much avoid getting destroyed entirely by moving straight into its line of sight, which there's some enemies we'll have to deal with that kind of thing in the future. At any rate, our permanent upgrades are the Blizzard Fire and Thunder Pockets. Not sure why it's called Thunder, because that's only the noise. But if we ever leave and return, they won't be back, so. On the bright side, the skeletons will be back, if you're into that, so there you go. Let's put down two Blizzard Magicites right here. Lock that down. Can I lure them out? And activate! There we go. Let's take some easy pickings here. Alright, two of them down, not too much to worry about. I might as well kill these guys since I want a little bit of easy EXP. I would like to be slightly above power, just ever so slightly, just so I don't have to worry about things. Have my odds stacked a little bit towards me, not against me. And that would be really, really good, since some of these areas I'm not too sure about going through entirely, I'll be honest. Anyway, there's a bat over here. Not too much to worry about. We'll kill him anyways, though. You can also hang underneath bats, which is similar to stomping, but I wouldn't recommend it unless you have a very specific perk that allows you to do a little bit more damage with this stuff. It's usually just something to just combat the slow attack speed that Silkies have, and otherwise isn't too much of a big thing. Stomp on you, do a hit, not too good. Let's do two stomps so you raise your lovely falchion, whatever you want to call it, at me, and then hop back down. So far, so good. Alright. A moo to deal with as well. Now, I'm going to try to avoid those skeletons up there, since those guys will be spawning nearby the key, and I don't want to run back and forth. Ouch. Okay. So far, so good, though. It looks like we'll be able to go through this thing in just enough time. Of course, these videos are very long, so I'm thinking I'll probably upload these once a week or something. I have no idea how I want to do with this kind of stuff. Regardless, there's a skeleton. Let's take care of you. There we go. Almost done. There we go. All right. I believe the key spawns around here. No, I'm way off. All right. There's a dark splotch on the ground here. Aim for the corner, I guess. All right, let's just pick up these items beforehand, and now we're good to go. It's going to be so strange having a bunch of pop-ups show up. It's going to be so strange adding a bunch of pop-ups about item descriptions. But anyways, this is where you deal with the boss, and if you didn't believe me, bad vibes beyond this point. Kupo, brace yourselves, Kupo. So that's something to consider. You should go in with a full bar of HP. And with that, let's go start that fight. Alright, so the skeleton, the scorpion, I mean, might be able to do a little bit of damage against you if you're playing as the Selkie or the Loti class, I believe. But that shouldn't have any problem since they're able to combo and take the full benefit of that drilling attack he just did. And Yukes get a double attack, which includes a melee attack, so they should be just fine. Lotis are a little bit slow early game, so they might have something to worry about. And Selkies with their bows are very slow, as you can tell. So instead, what we want to do is hop on their back and try to get on top of their tails and immediately hit the crystal this way. This is a lot easier, you do a lot of damage, and it's pretty generally easy to avoid. When it's drilling the ground, you can always hop on top of it and just attack it regularly like that, since you do a lot of damage still, or rather, you attack faster than you normally would. The chests around this battle area are entirely consisting of healing items, so don't bother with them, and just, I don't know, open them as you need them. At the end of it, if you don't, the good news is that you'll have a bunch of healing items that you can procure for future fights. I don't know, sell them. Do whatever you do with Magicites. I just got smacked. Not too good for us. So he's very, very weak, so two drill attacks, and we're pretty much down in these early boss fights. Albeit, we're probably in the same league as every other class in terms of that drilling thing. A huge emphasis on this first fight is healing items, which is why it's set up like this. Great bunch of potatoes and cure magicite, stuff like that. Otherwise, this fight is just fine, actually. They have a very... The scorpion has a very, very predictable pattern, which I often get hit by. So I'm just going to heal up now. While he's busy charging up a laser against Raylazor, which I don't appreciate, let's go around here and grab some items if we can. Okay, not so good with the potato. Not even going to be able to get it, and that's unfortunate because these items despawn if they're outside their chest for a little too long. Anyway, since he did a laser charge, I am fortunate enough to get a few extra hits in, and as you can see, his health bar is going down pretty well. It looks like we're going to be able to beat this boss pretty quickly. And after this, I want to head right back into the dungeon in order to do a speedrun area version of it. I don't want to head to town right away because this... we get a bunch of weird equipment pollinated into a regular pool and that would be a little bit weird. Oh, I am in a very dangerous spot right now. Please tell me you have stuff in it. There we go. Let's grab this, heal up, and it looks like we're good to go. There we go. Didn't even need to use one technically, but we're okay. Alright, this is the terrible point where if I have a bunch of uncollected items from earlier. They're all gonna show up on screen now. Fledgling's weapon, copper. Dark crystals, okay, that's probably a Neo description. Tall cloth, not so much. Oak branch, no. Alright, and a scorpion shell. So, if I did my things properly, there should only be two item descriptions popped up on screen, one after another. And with that, we've completed the Valley of Heroes entirely in its 100% form. Let's go screw some things up. There we go. So, for the most part, you always feel like fighting the enemies at the starting area because you've been akin to, it's taught you to do this in story mode, yet here you are as a lovely Selkie running past these guys saying, you know what, I don't need to worry about them. They're sort of in my pathway, but I run pretty quickly and I jump pretty far. So, we can just head on through, push this oddly shaped perfect cube through this area here. Don't know why people left that. Maybe the boulder was meant for something later on. Either or, we've been completely covered in it, so there's going to be sand in her hair all day. Nothing to worry about, really. Alright, and now since we're a Selkie, we can just move on over to the safe zone immediately. I recommend you do this for any other class as well. But because we're a Selkie, we don't have to worry about pushing one block, but rather one other block. Half the labor, not too bad. Let's move on through, and the only things you need to really kill in order to unlock the area are those three skeletons over here. So let's just do that. I got up on the wrong area. Usually you want to go over here first, so you can just kill the last skeleton and immediately pick up the key. So let's just worry about you first. Not too much to worry about. Hopefully I'll be able to get the key positioning right. Usually you want the key to land on top of your head so you don't have to go through the pickup animation, which is a little bit bulky. There we go. Two down. End of the spot, is it right here? Oh, okay, well, I barely got it, but there it is. And this way we can change it for a faster pickup animation. And let's go in and fight the boss right away. And we'll skip the cutscene since we just watched it, like, I don't know, 2 minutes ago. That was actually a very fast run through. I'm pretty happy about that. Let's see how far we go with a scorpion fight, though, since we only have two Kira Magicites. We have a little bit more experience on our belt from killing three skeletons, I believe, so I don't know about what you, but we're pretty much veterans of this area at this point. And it is having a little bit of trouble dealing damage against me, actually. I'm very happy with how much progress we've made. So far, so good. Didn't get knocked off by his weird claw attack. Pretty good, pretty good. Everything is coming up Millhouse, really. Let's just keep trying to get on that. It's usually when he turns, that's usually what knocks you off. But not too much to worry about. We're pretty much like on cowboy prestige right here. We have barely gotten knocked off. I think that was our first time, no idea. So my lovely Calgary roots here are telling me, good job, Bray. You're real good at stampeding, even though I am nothing like a cowboy. I like watching shows about cowboys, kind of. Well, one of them. Pretty much what anyone can guess. Alright. Land on top of you. Come on. Alright, I'm having a little bit of trouble wrangling this creature here. Darn and tarnation or something or another. Yahoo. I don't know what to say. Alright. I'm a little bit sleepy. We're pretty much near done. With that health bar being nearly exposed. Lovely. And we are good. There we go. Alright, and we get a free level up from that too. Not too bad whatsoever. Let's grab these things again, and you know what, we'll clear the chest since I could use a few extra cure items and whatnot, healing items. Alright, what's in you? Raise? No. I recommend buying raised mandracites to stack them against things. You and I both know that we don't feel like going through multiplay in its entirety over and over again. Raised mandracites are useless when you're a lonely single player like me. Most people don't play this game anymore, so you might as well carry a few raised mandracites as you need. Anyways, let's head on here and we'll be able to talk to some new strangers like this one right here. Hello, how are you doing? Welcome to Rebena Te Ra. Ah, it's good to be back doing what I do best. I decided to take a break and spend some time in town away from here, in a town away from here for a while. I thought I'd use the chance to get back in shape by doing some physical labor, you know? First day on the job, I drop a really expensive looking urn and smash it to bits. So here I am, back at my old job, making money to pay for that urn. Some vacation. Welcome to Rebena Te Ra! Welcome to Rebena Te Ra! Welcome to Rebena Te Ra! So that's sort of like a sports team cheer, right? Poor guy, if you wanted to get some physical labor in you, why didn't you just climb a mountain or something? Alright, and we have another fellow to talk to, which is hanging on over in this shopping district right here. Oh, hello there. Are you on an adventure? Our town isn't much, but please make yourself at home. Actually, the place may seem less appealing because hardly anyone's here. Where could they have gone? Even their shopkeepers are nowhere to be found. Oh, well, there you go. Signs. Talking to signs is the best. I have a feeling that a bunch of introverts like me would love this because you don't have to deal with talking to people in public. Don't try to start a conversation. I'm here to buy items and leave. If only they could take a book out of a page of the book of NPCs. That would be fantastic. Don't treat your people like NPCs. That's terrible. Alright, anyways, before we do our equipment... Actually, no, let's do our equipment thingy now. Let's go in here and see what we can buy. Alright, order. What do we have here? Child's weapon. Okay, we don't even need these. Let's sort by weapons first. So, we can get a fledgling's weapon. Okay, so this will get us a pretty good bow, I believe. A short bow. Now, I can equip it as is, but I want to try it a few more times because I'm going for a specific upgrade, which I think is that one. No, it isn't. That's a speed boost. Basically, without using any items, you should be able to get an attack boost, which I'm apparently not getting. Alright, so no big deal. I can just buy a few more tree branches, presuming they have them in stock. Otherwise, I'm going to have to stick... Okay, they only have one. Perfect. So I'm not going to be able to get the item I want today, despite doing two runs of the same area. And this is where it gets really miserable. So, alright, no, what do you call it? Sword again. Okay, no novice weapons today. Oh, right, the scrolls ran out. Right, okay. Well, what can we do here? We're probably going to go for bronze helms. So let's make one right here. Do we get defense? There we go. That's what I wanted. I think that's the only kind of upgrade you can really get with this stuff too. Bronze light armor requires a piece of leather, so let's make one of these right now. There we go. And let's see what we get. Please give me a star. There we go. And we get the defense boost we needed, so perfect on that regard. Not so much with the bow, but I can't really do anything about it now. Maybe I'll do it off screen. I'm going to have to find a way to show off these weapons that apply to Selkies one way or another. I have no idea what I'm going to do for this, but green headwear, hand-me-downs... we don't even have, like, the other piece of the green set. Green armor set. Terrible, really. And we go to the automated armory, however, this may be able to be fixed. So we can get all the current equipment, which we don't need. We have the green hat and all the other stuff that we have right here with its description, so... I don't know how I'm going to show this. Do I want to show this at the end of a video? Probably. This will be so much editing, I don't think I'll be able to make my mark. Definitely going to need a week for this kind of stuff. Just editing a bunch of stupid item descriptions with that. Because just by going through that shop inventory, we just flashed like, 16 pieces of equipment, 12, I don't know. I don't want to find out. Let's go do a quest. If we head in here, let's talk to King Koka. Might you be feeling the overwhelming urge to help us? I do, King Koka. Let's do switches galore. I know it's not the first one. And it might make his dialogue a little wonky, but it's okay. Switches galore is a very easy quest to do, and having a little bit of level up behind your back is always nice. Switch it, and switch it good. Da-na-na-na. Oh, you're ready to go. Then allow me to explain about this quest. That dialogue makes it terrible for someone like me to read. There have been recent reports of switches appearing in numbers... In the caves outside of town, once again, making it so hard for me to read. What the switches do, or what is causing this outbreak, we do not yet know. But if they're there, let's turn them on, I say. Unfortunately, we are currently short-staffed. This is why we are calling on brave and curious adventurers to go there on a quest. All you have to do is proceed through the caves and activate every switch in your sight. There is no telling what switches do when activated, but that is not my problem. Now off you go. I hope none of the switches make you unable to make it back alive. Yay, let's go flip switches. Don't flip his switch or else he's gonna hit me or something. I don't know. How does that saying goes? Goes. Alright, well, we can use our lovely skeleton hop on top thing tactic that we've discussed in this video in order to take these guys all out. They're a little bit weaker since they're level 1, but I still find it hard to complete the thing, the mission, fairly at level 1, so that's just why I never bothered showing a mission in the next previous video. So there we go. I'm still fretting over item descriptions right now. We might as well be a little bit more lenient since there's nothing really much else to talk about. As you can see, this is a new reskin area of the Valley of Heroes, so let's take care of these two. Blizzard pedestals? Let's not call them pedestals. Switches? Yeah, that's a switch. Let's call them all switches so I don't have to worry about anything awkward. There we go. Okay, missed. There we go. Alright, can we grab this in time? Yes, we can, and we completed the stage. Yay, and it only took us 55 seconds. So far, so good. This area is a little bit strange, though, because it's all surrounded by barriers. I believe you have to kill a few enemies and then activate some switches. Kill a few more, activate some switches. Some switches activate other switches. Something like that. Either or, the 11 is nothing too much to worry about. Now, usually you would want to hang out around here to grind and get some EXP since the enemies will never stop spawning, but that's a terrible idea since we do have a third stage to deal with, so I don't recommend that whatsoever. Come on, take you out. Another moo. We'll go check on the switches after this one. I don't think I heard a noise, but regardless, there we go. There are some switches available to be switched upon. Lovely, lovely. Any more around here? Okay. Oh, there we are. Two more. Lovely. Let's switch these guys as well. Does this activate anything here that I can switch? Perhaps? No? Okay. Well, let's worry about these skeletons then. Because we probably have to defeat these two in order to get a new unlockable switch. Please? Anything? No? Oh, okay. There we go. Two more switches done. Doesn't seem like the rest are going to be activated. We got invincible, which will make us pretty much do critical hit damage and never take damage. I think we're able to shoot a little bit faster too. I'm not too sure about that. Okay, does this activate something else? Yes, it does. Great. Just gonna avoid you guys entirely. And those two switches will activate three more switches. And we're done. There we go. Haha, I'm taunting you because you don't get to die and I don't get to die and I get to teleport elsewhere. Yay, giant wood carving switch thing. Who put this here? What's the purpose? I don't know. Anyways, it's a very good idea to come into this with magicites, which you don't really get when you're doing your first low area, which is why it's recommended you do the first mission first. But that mission is kind of hard since you have to deal with a bunch of monsters with no prior magicite knowledge. Terrible, terrible time. Let's take care of these. And if you don't have enough magicites, I believe the enemies will drop a few. But it's always good to keep some in stock. You're going to need three for each, I believe. Since there's three sets of switches here, I'm not too sure. Where's that fire one? Okay, there it is. Alright. And we got a firebomb hanging around here too. Alright, well, yeah, I didn't really expect you to get hit by that since you're a giant orange target. Regardless, we got a thunder magicite, which I did not want. Please drop a blizzard, because I need one of those. Okay, cool. That is exactly what I didn't want. Awesome, let's just activate these things. And hopefully we'll get a blizzard eventually, or else we might be in some trouble. Okay, well, let's kill this monster over here since... Oh, okay. Wow, hey, nice. Where'd you get that, son? Okay, wow, this is weird. This is like the awkward high school reunion right now, when your friends are dead and skeletons, for example. Alright, let's pick this stuff up. Go back here. Activate the switch, please. And there we go. Okay, so, a wood block should have spawned, and it did. So we got a nice round piece right now. And as you can see, we only have three switches to deal with. So let's run around and quickly put these in. And this is the reason why you don't really want to play around in stage 2 for too long. Because this kind of thing actually takes a little bit, since you need to do a little bit of legwork running back and forth. The first time I went through this, I actually forgot about the third stage, which is why I'm emphasizing it so much today. And that took me like, oh, that was miserable. Let's not even talk about that. With that, we completed the quest. Lovely. 4 minutes 35 seconds of your time ruined, but we unlocked white cats, black cats, if you're into cats. We have unlocked Come on. Area 51 if you're into cow abducting and stuff like that. And, okay, well, guess not. Okay, whatever, we get rewards. I am glad to see you back alive. Your skills were most impressive. The people of this country are most grateful for your heroics of flipping switches, and I thank you on their behalf of flipping switches. This should aid in recovering our economic- Oh, never mind that. Please accept a small token of our appreciation. By the way, we could not decide on how to distribute our gifts, so we sort of just rummaged through a garbage can. You shall race for what you can grab within the allotted time. Whether you want to approach this in a cooperative or cutthroat way is entirely up to you. Go! Now, the part about the garbage thing, yeah, that's kind of true. A lot of these items are useless. Iron shard, are you kidding me? Copper shard? Light bronze armor? That doesn't help us. Stop, and good day till we meet again. And this is literally something that happens pretty much every time. I don't even bother. I don't even bother with quests after like one time through them. There's no point. Before we end this though, you can always go back to the Moogle shop and I believe they'll give you something new in stock. There we go. And technically with our two speed runs, we should have been able to get two sets of Mogmart stuff. But since we did them both at once, we only got one. Not too worried about that since I don't need to be a little too overpowered. Since this stuff does stack over time. Before we do anything else though, I believe we can talk to these guys for one extra line of dialogue. I wonder how long it'll be till the shop folks are back. Shopping isn't as satisfying with only a sign out front. I can't speak well. I can't read well. Everything is terrible. Alright, let's go talk to the greeter as well. Welcome to Rebena Te Ra. Not many townsfolks are back, but we welcome all adventurers. With a bunch of sign storefronts for introverted adventurers off to see absolutely nothing. Thank you for watching this lovely episode of Ring of Fates. Stay around if you want a bunch of, I don't know, item descriptions or something. Is this how I do this? This is not staged. This is not planned. I have no idea what's going on here. Listen, you look at the YouTube bar, alright? If it's a little bit longer, you can stay around for a bunch of item descriptions and stuff like that. I don't know how I want to set that thing up, but they're there for you if you want them. And in the next one, we'll take on Old Town.